The Iron Pigs actually plated three runs in the fourth inning and lead 6-0. There was the RBI bases loaded walk, the two-run single from Ashy. We head to the fifth inning, 6-0 for Ethan Martin. And for the play-by-play here in inning number five, to my left, here's John Skudras.
Well, I appreciate that, John Schaefer. And the Iron Pigs back-to-back innings with three runs on the board in the bottom of the third and fourth, and right now leading 6-0 as we trickle ahead in this ball game to the top of the fifth inning. Ethan Martin is ready. He, as mentioned, will face Justin Henry. And the right-hander's first pitch is a fastball right down the heart of the plate for strike one. For Henry, he's 0-1 with a strikeout looking, and Martin working very quickly here in the fifth inning, and another fastball misses inside. Henry on the season, a .229 batting average, and here is the 1-1 pitch. Grounded up the first baseline, Fields will watch as it goes foul right in front of the bag for strike two. For Ethan Martin, in his last two games here at Coca-Cola Park, stellar numbers, 15 innings, just one run allowed. Here's the 1-2 pitch from the right-hander, and it's a curveball that is cued down the left field line and out of play. It'll stay 1-2 to the left-handed hitter, Justin Henry. Six runs in for Lehigh Valley. A 6-0 lead as Ethan Martin delivers. A 1-2 is just a bit low. For ball two, 2-2 to Justin Henry. Martin continues to work swiftly, and his windup and delivery is slugged right behind the plate for strike two. It's 2-2 to Henry. And John Schaefer, so far this series, the Pawtucket Red Sox lineup has looked like their socks have been left in the dryer.
Fair analogy.
Martin is ready. The 2-2 curveball just low, and it's going to be a full count to Justin Henry.
And if it's anything like mine, John, if it's anything like what I have going on, they don't match. And you've lost a bunch of socks as a result of it.
That's an epidemic for me as well, Matt Province, as a fastball on 3-2 is taken inside for ball four. And like that, the Paw Sox have a leadoff base runner, the dreaded leadoff base on balls, as he reared its ugly head at Ethan Martin. And with nobody out in the fifth inning, there's a leadoff base runner for Xander Bogaerts.
You know, Pawtucket, John, has only scored four runs in this series. This is the fourth game of the series. They're scoreless tonight off Martin and now trailing by six. So this is some serious work to do for the Paw Sox.
Right you are, as a pickoff attempt at first is not in time. Henry back in. Xander Bogaerts was our guest on the AT&T pregame show a day ago. Very nice young man from Aruba, as a swing and a miss for strike one. He was a member of the Netherlands World Baseball Classic team, guys, and I don't know how much of the WBC you guys got a chance to catch, but I thought it was really a thrill to be able to watch.
Especially the excitement of the Dominican team, like that it meant that much to them, certainly was awesome and validated its existence.
Ethan Martin's 0-1 pitch is a fastball in the outside corner to Bogaerts, and it's nothing in two. The Dominican team, of course, won the World Baseball Classic this year. United States, a disappointing finish as Ethan Martin is set. The 0-2 pitch, and this one's launched into left field, way back, and that one is gone. You can write a postcard because she is out of here. A two-run home run from Xander Bogaerts, his sixth of the season. And just like that, it is 6-2, Iron Pig still leading.
Now, there may be a lot of those in the career of Bogaerts, John. I mean, here's a kid that is only 20 years of age playing AAA baseball, and you see the talent that makes him one of the top prospects on the infield in all of baseball.
Absolutely. Xander Bogaerts showing some of that raw power that the Red Sox saw when they signed him as an international free agent in 2009. He has since really burst onto the scene, and I'm sure just weeks or months away from stepping into Fenway Park as a Boston Red Sox. So now Martin will toil with Ronald Bermudez, and the first pitch is a fastball for strike one. For Bermudez, 237, no home runs, 10 ribbies coming in, as the 0-1 pitch is a curveball that didn't curve, and it hits Bermudez on the thigh for another base runner as Martin's command has suddenly begun to erode.
Yeah, didn't walk anyone in the first four innings, walks a batter to begin the fifth. Allows the home run and hits a batter.
I'll make the argument, John and John, that I always seem to make, and that's sometimes when you get too big of a lead, you know, as a pitcher, I really do think it affects some psyche, not everybody. But I think Martin's pitching a lot of close games this year, and he's kept his team right there. And then in other games where they've scored a lot, he's allowed some, but he's obviously kept the Pigs ahead by his record, 9-4. And I almost wonder if getting too big of a lead, 6-0, put him a little bit too much back on his heels. I might be making excuses for him, but having seen every inning, every pitch he's thrown this year, you know, sometimes you know you almost pitch to the competition.
Martin is set to face the 9-hole hitter Alberto Rosario as he cues one foul and out of play behind home plate. Right you are, and it doesn't help either when his past two innings, he's had to sit in the dugout for 20, 25 minutes waiting for the Iron Pigs to do their damage to the starting pitcher for Pawtucket, Charlie Hager. It's nothing and one to the 9-hole hitter Rosario, and the pitch from Martin is a fastball outside corner for strike two, nothing and two. Rosario singled in his first at-bat with one down in the third inning. One on, two in here in the top of the fifth inning. Martin is set, and the 0-2 pitch, curveball, it's cued too short, might be two. Galvis flips to second for one, over to first, and a double play. And just like that, Ethan Martin gets two down for the price of one. And the top of the order will be up in the form of Jonathan Diaz. And remember, fans, for every double play turned by the Iron Pigs this season, Univest Bank and Trust Company will donate $25 to Wildlands Conservancy. Univest is a member of FDIC and preferred SBA lender, is your community banking partner in Bucks, Chester, and Montgomery counties, and, of course, the Lehigh Valley. So now two down and two in. Deuces are wild here in the fifth inning. It'll be Jonathan Diaz, and a first-pitch fastball is on the outside corner for strike one. Martin doing a good job of painting those corners to get ahead. The 0-1 pitch is in there for strike two. It was a changeup, 86 miles per hour from Cash Martin. And look at that. He just gets right back on the rubber, ready to go. The 0-2 pitch to Diaz is just outside for ball one.
And I will say this, and we talked about Martin in the home run a moment ago, but he is a guy that can bounce back very quickly. We've seen that in a lot of starts this season, and here after the two-run home run, he's gotten right back into the form.
Certainly has. As a 1-2 pitch, it's a curveball called strike three, and the inning is over. So Ethan Martin allows two runs on one hit, a two-run bomb from Xander Bogaerts, his sixth. However, a 6-4-3 double play from Rosario followed by a strikeout looking of Jonathan Diaz, and the Pigs get out of it with the lead. We're through 4.5 from Coca-Cola Park. It's Iron Pigs 6, Pawtucket Red Sox 2 on the Iron Pigs Radio Network. Thank you, Kenny Ayers, back here from Coca-Cola Park. I am John Skudras, along with John Schaefer and Matt Province here on the Iron Pigs Radio Network. Pigs lead at 6-2 as we head to the bottom of the fifth inning. Lehigh Valley getting three runs in the third, three runs in the fourth. Cody Ashey, a huge catalyst. He's got five RBIs as part of a 3-for-3 day for the Iron Pigs third baseman.
I tell you what, too, man, he was close to that grand slam. And, you know, the Pigs have had a lot of grand slams over their history, but this year they have still been stuck for quite some time on two Codys. One Cody, one Overbeck, one for Ashey.
This isn't a Cody, but it's Josh Fields, and he lifts one to deep left center field. Center fielder out there to make the play as it is brought in out there in center by Ronald Bermudez for the first out. Josh swinging at the first pitch he saw, and he's retired. Now 0-for-3, struck out his first two at-bats, so maybe he just wanted to make some contact. And it's one down. It'll bring up the rehabbing Iron Pig, Eric Kratz.
And I thought that ball may have gone a little bit farther out there than what Josh Fields initially thought. When he hit it, he kind of threw his bat like, just flat out again. But that ball took the center fielder all the way back to the warning track as the wind continues to blow out that way.
Here's the first pitch to Kratz from the knuckleballer Hager, and it's a knuckleball taken outside, 1-0. Yeah, you said it, and it's, as Charlie Manuel would say, it's hitting season here at Coca-Cola Park. The wind blowing out, the temperature warm and humid. Here's the 1-0 pitch and another off-speed pitch. That one is on the outside corner. Paints it for strike one. 1-1 with one down here in the bottom of the fifth inning. Iron Pigs leading 6-2. You're listening to the Iron Pigs Radio Network. Here is a 1-1 pitch, and Kratz way out in front of that one. Swung on and missed for strike two. Hager's been beating that outside corner with the knuckleball all night long, and it's worked against the right-handed hitters. It hasn't worked against the left-handers such as Galvis and Hernandez and Ashy, who is 3-for-3 with 5 RBIs. Here is the 1-2 pitch from Hager. A fastball grounded out to shortstop. It's going to be gobbled up out there and thrown across the diamond for the out. A 6-3 put out. Diaz makes the play, and there are quickly two down in the bottom half of the fifth inning. So Ethan Martin, who had to labor a little bit in the top half of the fifth inning, will move on to the sixth with 76 pitches. Should be good for at least one or perhaps two more innings. And it'll bring up Steve Susdorf, who's hitting .337 this season. Steve, no registered at-bats, 2 walks so far this year. First pitch from Hager is grounded right up the middle, and wouldn't you know it, right as I say it, Steve Susdorf records his first single of the game, taking it back from where it came, up the middle for a base hit.
How textbook is that guy?
He is a phenomenal hitter, that's for certain. And as I mentioned to John Schaefer earlier on, he was almost quizzical as to why he didn't have more home runs this season, just one, and it happened in Columbus. I think the home runs will come, though. So Hager is going to have a two-out base runner against him. It's Susdorf at first for the third time in this game, and it'll bring up the seven-hole hitter, Michael Martinez. He's 1-for-2, and the first pitch is a knuckleball outside for ball one. Minimart single back in the fourth inning. He then came around to score on an RBI base knock from Freddy Galvis. It's 1-0 as Hager continues to labor through the mid portion of this game. A pickoff move to first is late as Susdorf stretches back in time. Minimart is one of those players who has been scorching hot. Was hitting her in the 270s a few weeks ago. Before you know it, he's .318. Here's the 1-0 pitch to Minimart, and he skies it foul. I think this one's going to reach out of play just into the Iron Pigs dugout. Rosario gave chase, but he comes up empty, and it is now going to be 1-1 to Minimart.
Well, I worried a little bit about the knuckleballer, John, and, you know, you look at this, 8 hits now through 4 2/3 innings. They are, you know, in theory, if you count the suspended game, 2 hits away from their 5th consecutive double-digit hit total, something they have yet to do all year long.
Well, this is where pigs fly, and they've certainly been speeding around the base pass high, low, to and fro as they have taken a 6-2 lead on a pair of 3-run innings. Now it's 1-1 with 2 down to Michael Martinez. Another pickoff move at first. Susdorf dives back in time. Hager concerned about Steve Susdorf. He had a delayed steal earlier on in this game. In this inning, we have a fly out to center from Josh Fields, a ground out to short from Eric Kratz, and a single from Steve Susdorf, and like that, the Iron Pigs have a man on with 2 down for Minimart. Iron Pigs leading 6-2 here in the bottom of the fifth inning. I am John Skoudras, along with Matt Provinz and John Schaefer, here on the Iron Pigs Radio Network. Hager is set, takes another peek at Susdorf, and yet another throw over as he's significantly concerned about Steve Susdorf. It's not like he's Cesar Hernandez out there, though.
You know who's not concerned is John Byrne. He never signaled safe. He never signaled out. I thought that was a pretty close play over there.
So Hager maybe will deliver one, but now we have timeout behind the plate as the backstop, Rosario, wants to rethink the pitch selection. It's 1-1 to Michael Martinez, 2 outs here in the bottom of the fifth inning. And a pitch out. Susdorf got a little bit off the bag there, a big lead. Might have thought about a delayed steal. Good move to get back. And now 2-1.
Well, one hurdle is beating a knuckleballer. The next hurdle will be not letting the knuckleballer disrupt your team rhythm. And we'll see tomorrow if there's any ramifications or any spillover, but they've hit Hager very well.
Here's the 2-1, and it's lined up the middle, a base hit for Michael Martinez. Hager had to throw that glove in front of his face, fearing for his life, as that one was a scorching shot back at number 28, but it's through to center and back-to-back singles with 2 down, and the Iron Pigs have some home cooking here for Pete Orr.
It really doesn't matter for Michael Martinez, does it? I mean, this guy is so dialed in, and it's been such a long period now, 21 games of being nearly a 500 hitter. There are a lot of good swingers in beer league softball that can't even continue going at that pace. And he has been fabulous here with Lehigh Valley since coming down from Philadelphia.
Might not be long till he finds his way back on the Phillies 40-man roster with the way he has been tearing up the International League. So now with two down, there are two on for Pete Orr. And a knuckleball is taken outside for ball one. Orr on the evening, 0 for 2 with two flyouts to center field. Hasn't seen many pitches, three in total. 233 coming in. And the 1-0 pitch to Pete Orr is just missed getting a chunk of that one as it's fouled back. Hager came back with a fastball there, had to wear off balance. It'll be 1-1 to the Iron Pigs right fielder. Hager is set, the 1-1 and a swing on and a foul tip. It looks like Pete Orr would have much rather laid off that one. He's smiling at himself. Unfortunately, now it's 1-2 with two down to the Iron Pigs right fielder. Orr has been a member of the Pigs for three seasons now. As Hager is set, two men on, two down, and a 1-2 pitch. And a knuckleball flutters high, 2-2. It's exactly where Hager doesn't want to leave them. Pigs have six runs on nine hits, no errors. Meanwhile, the Red Sox have two runs on three hits with no errors, and Hager is set. Deuce is wild, 2-2, two outs, and it is up high again, and it is going to be 3-2, so the runners will be off.
All starting with two outs, too, and remember, they had nothing stirring before Susdorf brought out his fundamentals and lined another base hit. Martinez followed, so they have done it every which way so far against Hager.
Anytime you can have Susdorf and Martinez towards the bottom of the order, it's a plus. Here is Hager. The runners go 3-2, and it's chopped foul just behind home plate. Orr will stay alive here in the fifth inning. A strong crowd here at Coca-Cola Park. Doesn't look like it's quite capacity, but still a very significant tangent of the fans and faithful. Excuse me, contingent. So it's going to be 3-2. To Pete Orr with two down and two men on base. Hager sets. There they go. The 3-2, and he just got a piece of another knuckleball. And Orr doing a great job to fight off Charlie Hager's stuff here in the fifth inning. This inning began with the Iron Pigs sending Josh Fields to the dish. She flew out to center. Eric Kratz then grounded out to short. Back-to-back singles from Susdorf and Martinez now have two men on with two down and a 3-2 pitch to Pete Orr. If Orr reaches, Gillies is on deck. Hager set. There they go. And this one is ripped down the left field line, but foul as people's doing some ducking, and it's corralled by the ball girl down the third baseline here at Coca-Cola Park. Pigs looking to complete a sweep of their division rivals, the Pawtucket Red Sox. Came into this series seven games back. All of a sudden are right in the thick of things. Here's another 3-2 pitch to Orr. Another knuckleball grounded to second. Gobbled up out there, and the play will be made by Justin Henry. 4-3 the putout, and the inning is over. Pigs don't score, but they get two hits, leave them on base, and we're moving to the sixth inning here from Coca-Cola Park. Pigs are out in front on the Pawtucket Red Sox 6-2 on the Iron Pigs Radio Network. Welcome back here to Coca-Cola Park for the top of the sixth inning. I am John Skudras along with John Schaefer and our guest here in the top of the sixth inning, Steve Aronson. And Steve, first off, welcome to the booth.
Thank you, John. Always a pleasure to hear you on the radio as well.
Well, I appreciate that. Ethan Martin on the mound, and he's getting set for his sixth inning of work, and the first pitch is a fastball off the outside corner. Drew Sutton is up for the Paw Sox, the number two hitter. Switch hitter batting left. He's 0 for 2 on the night. Martin continues to work quickly, and another fastball is fouled back. No, 1-1. So, Steve, I assume you make a lot of trips out here to Coca-Cola Park. For myself, this is my first opportunity.
Well, My wife and I have been season ticket holders for 3 years and have been plan holders for the whole time. So we love the Iron Pigs, and we love this venue. It's one of the most beautiful ballparks we've ever been to.
It absolutely is. It's an honor to be calling the broadcast from the concourse here on a beautiful Wednesday evening. As the 1-1 pitch was fouled off down the first base line by Sutton, and now Martin's 1-2 is another fastball taken low.
And this is another good night for the Iron Pigs so far. I don't want to jinx them, but terrific.
It certainly has been, and this whole series, all you've been treated to as a fan is hits, hits, and more hits. The 1-2 pitch is fouled back, and it's going to be another two-strike count.
Cody Ashe particularly lining up the board a little bit tonight.
Five RBIs for the Iron Pigs third baseman, and if you have a favorite player on the Iron Pigs, Steve, who might it be?
That's the one.
Cody?
Generally...
As this 2-2 pitch is lined out to right, Pete Orr on the run, and a diving play by Pete Orr. What a play by the Iron Pigs right fielder, ranging to his left.
Rich Thompson was our favorite player for as long as with the Iron Pigs, but one player generally captures my attention during the course of a year. Two years ago, it was Brandon Moss. Last year, it was Kevin Franson, and this year, this guy at third base is just something else.
That's interesting because Brandon Moss, of course, has become quite an accomplished hitter with the Oakland Athletics. Kevin Franson with the Phillies. Maybe Cody Ashe next year will be manning the hot corner in the majors. Here's the first pitch to Will Middlebrooks. One down now here in the top of the sixth inning on a phenomenal diving play out in right field by Pete Orr. And he's just another one of these veterans that the Iron Pigs have placed out in the corner outfield, and they seem to flourish. Martin's set. He winds and dines and delivers, and it's 1-1 now after a foul ball up into the club level ahead of our vantage point.
For me, it's kind of a conflict because, you know, you want these guys to do well and make the major leagues, and you want to see them play here for the Iron Pigs and help the Iron Pigs win. So always a conflict, but we love what Kevin Franson's doing for the Phillies, and hope Darren Ruff can get in that groove as well.
Well, Darren's certainly been hitting the ball well since he's been with the Phillies this past week, and Kevin Franson had a walk-off home run earlier on this season as it's 2-1 now to Will Middlebrooks. The third baseman for the Paw Sox stands in, and he takes a fastball on the outside corner, painting the outside corner as Ethan Cash Martin. He's been money, and now it's 2-2. One down here in the top of the sixth inning. And now the 2-2 pitch is just off the outside corner. And Steve, we've seen a lot of umpiring gaffes that have seemed to come back and haunt the Iron Pigs here over the course of the season. A couple of weeks ago, I'm not sure if you were at the game where there was a couple of strike threes towards the end of the game.
Oh, boy. I was there. It was the day before July 3rd, I think.
Yeah,
it was July 2nd, and we were here. And as I mentioned to Matt and John the next night, they got hosed.
Oh, absolutely. It was almost as if the umpire just didn't want to be there anymore. So here is Martin 3-2. Get back to that in a minute as Middlebrooks launches one way out of here. Foul.
You know, we were at the game last night, and I think Dan Vines was behind the plate. And for one of the only times this year, it looked like everything was pretty consistent. He was calling balls and strikes the same for both teams, and pretty accurately, I think.
We've gotten a pretty good call here tonight. 3-2, and Middlebrooks chased. A fastball low and away, and Middlebrooks had no answers, swinging and missing. And there's two down as Kratz's throw down to third base launches into left field. Luckily, nobody on base.
Seven strikeouts now for Martin, who has this 6-2 lead. He's pitched very well. He's an out away from a quality start of six innings.
And we were talking about the Iron Pigs losing their players to the big leagues. The bullpen has been ravaged by Philadelphia as the first pitch comes into Mark Hamilton, and he takes
Garcia,
one outside.
Garcia, the latest.
Luis Garcia. What a story that is. A young man who was cutting hair just a year ago, and now here he is pitching for the Philadelphia Phillies in the major leagues. The 1-0 pitch is a fastball low, 2-0 to Hamilton. He's 0-2, struck out in the fourth inning, grounded out to second in the second, hitting .270 coming in.
You wonder what happens, how these guys get found even. A guy like Puig, for example, and then Luis Garcia. How?
The 2-0 pitch to Hamilton is grounded through the hole on the right side for a base hit. Brought a fastball at 91, but Hamilton sent it out at a speed much faster. And there's a two-out base runner. Yeah, certainly. Advanced scouting at this stage in professional baseball is astounding where they find some of these kids. Yasiel Puig, a Cuban defector. You find a A lot of Latin American talents these days signed as 15 or 16-year-olds. Amazing that they end up developing. So now with a man on first and two down, it'll bring up J.C. Linares, the right fielder here for Pawtucket. Linares is 1-for-2 with a double. So now Martin will come out of the stretch, and a fastball is right there, strike one.
Just watching his pitching. Tyler Cloyd last night, again, what a turnaround that was.
Absolutely, and much needed for the Iron Pigs. Here's the 0-1 pitch, and it plunks him with a fastball, 89 miles per hour, right off the left arm it looked. And Linares will be feeling that one tomorrow. It'll be two men on base with two down now, and an opportunity for Pawtucket to get a little rally going. Justin Henry, the second baseman, steps into the dish. Don't want to be taking that one in your arm, they, Steve.
Not tonight or any other night.
Here comes the Iron Pigs pitching coach, Ray Burris. You know, if one more reaches here, John, in the inning, the tying run would come to the plate. It could be Xander Bogaerts, who is homered tonight.
Bogaerts, in the fifth inning, last frame, delivered a two-run bomb to left field into the Iron Pigs bullpen and got the Pigs lead to four. Right now, two men on base, two down here in the top half of the sixth frame. And Justin Henry, a left-handed hitter, due up. A beautiful night for baseball.
We spoke about this last week, that all these forecasts for the terrible weather that was supposed to come, it hasn't come. Except what happened was we talked about it hasn't come, and then about 10 minutes later, it was an hour and 5 minute rain delay.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
Knock on some wood here as the Iron Pigs lead by four runs. Granted, we're past the point of no return, so if a significant rain delay does occur, the Iron Pigs will win this game. 6-2, Lehigh Valley out in front, and the first pitch from Martin's in the dirt. 1-0 to Justin Henry. Henry walked and scored a run in his last at bat. And you were saying, Steve, that the weather has been beautiful. I saw earlier today it was supposed to rain, and doesn't look like it. The sky looks pretty nice to me.
Yeah, it's nice out there now.
It's 1-0 as Martin's in the stretch. Here's the pitch, and it's high and outside, 2-0.
As Ernie Banks used to say, let's play three.
We might have you out here doing play-by-play by the third game.
Yeah.
It's 2-0 now to Justin Henry, and Ethan Martin has quickly fallen behind.
Some of these three-hour games do get a little testy sometimes.
He was taking all the way as it's a fastball in the outside corner. Two-seamer for strike one. 2-1 to the Paw Sox second baseman. From Philadelphia, not good news. The Nationals lead the Phillies 4-0 after six innings. Cliff Lee against Gio Gonzalez. So Martin is set. Here's the 2-1, and this one's grounded up the middle. That's going to be a base hit. Diving attempt by Hernandez was not in time. Coming around to score will be the runner from second base. That is Mark Hamilton, and just like that, it's a 6-3 game with two down and two on. Runners at the corners with two down.
And now the tying run does come to the plate in the form of Bogaerts, who has homered. So we'll see if Lehigh Valley has a decision to make here. Burris has come out looking down at Brundage in the dugout. The Iron Pigs do have a right-handed pitcher up, but it appears as if they will stick with Martin here.
Martin is a bullish pitcher, and he's certainly not going to be intimidated by anybody. Xander Bogaerts went deep to left field off him his last time up. Native of Aruba, played for the Netherlands in the World Baseball Classic, a top prospect for the Red Sox. First pitch is a fastball outside. Actually, it was a changeup. Pardon me, as that's 1-0. Martin is set. Runners at the corners, two down. Bogaerts takes a fastball low. And now for the second consecutive hitter, Ethan Martin has fallen behind 2-0. And the getting may be good here for Xander Bogaerts if they give him a green light. Right-handed hitter against a right-handed pitcher. Martin sets 2-0. All right. On the inside corner, called strike one. Good call there by Blue.
I saw some interesting news this morning about the championship game here at Coca-Cola Park on September 17th. Some celebrity horses are coming here.
Oh, is that so?
The Clydesdales.
That should be exciting as the 2-1 pitch is swung on and missed on a changeup. And just like that, it's Bogarts in the hole here, 2-2 with two down. That should be exciting, the national championship game, John Schaefer.
Yeah, it's 2 months from the 17th of July. Champions of the IL and the Pacific Coast League coming here for the first time.
It's a 6-3 score. Deuces are wild. 2-2, 2 down, 2-1. Here's the pitch from Martin. Swung on and missed. He struck him out. Got him with an off-speed pitch, and Xander Bogarts goes fishing. So Martin puts two men on base, allows a run, but gets out of any further damage. We are through 5.5 innings from Coca-Cola Park. We thank Steve Aronson for spending some time with us here in the top of the fifth inning. And as we head to the bottom of the fifth inning, it's 6-3 Iron Pigs on the Iron Pigs Radio Network.
It's the Sixers.
Welcome back to Coca-Cola Park here on the Iron Pigs Radio Network. I am John Skoudras along with John Schaefer and our guest here in the bottom half of the sixth inning, Steve Aronson. Iron Pigs will have an opportunity once again. They'll send the nine-hole hitter Tyson Gillies to face Charlie Hager, who remains out here for his sixth inning of work. Gillies on the evening has had his most stellar dish or evening at the dish this season. He's 2-for-2 with a triple and a single, scoring twice. 6-3 Iron Pigs as Hager is ready. Gillies is in. Left-handed batter takes the first pitch high and inside for ball one. Tyson Gillies, of course, came back to the Iron Pigs a few weeks ago. Now manning the outfield for Lehigh Valley. Doing a fantastic job of it as a fastball at 80 miles an hour is off the outside corner for ball two.
It's funny when you can say a fastball is 80 miles an hour, but it's true.
It almost fools you when you watch it, which is why these knuckleballers are so successful.
As base hit.
He wasn't successful on that one. Another fastball at 80 is timed up well by Gillies. Right back up the middle, and as Steve mentioned, it is a base hit for the leadoff hitter, Tyson Gillies. So the Pigs have something cooking here in the bottom of the sixth inning. It'll be a one-out base runner, excuse me, a leadoff base runner for Cesar Hernandez.
Yeah, this has become a big night for Gillies, who has really found his footing at the plate. I mean, when he went down to double A, he was not hitting in triple A, but he starts hit down there, finished well, and has hit now in 8 of 9 games since coming back.
Left-handed hitter Hernandez waits, and Hager's first pitch is a knuckleball outside. Yeah, Gillies, with this 3-for-3 performance, will probably see his average creep up to the Mendoza line. So 1-0 to Cesar Hernandez, and the Iron Pigs here in the middle portion of this game have been getting to Charlie Hager. Gillies has speed. It won't go here as Hernandez rips a changeup down the right field line and foul. Cesar, one of two International League All-Stars to be played on July 17th from Reno, Nevada, along with Cody Ashey, who was in the hole. Here's the 1-1 pitch. Instead, we will have a pickoff move to first. If he's keeping a tab on Susdorf, something tells me he'll want to keep an eye on Tyson Gillies.
Have you been to Reno before, Steve?
Actually, a long, long time ago. Took a train from San Francisco, went through the Donner Pass there, really pretty. It's an interesting place, but not one I would care to go back to.
I certainly have never been there. It would be very interesting.
Andy Tracy spent some time there a couple of years ago. After he left the Iron Pigs, he spent maybe one season, hit a few home runs.
Yep.
Hager's set, and now he's going to make a pickoff move. His last pitch was swung on and missed by Hernandez, so it's going to be 1-2 to the Iron Pigs leadoff hitter. Gillies at first base, nobody out here in the bottom half of the sixth inning.
Iron Pigs have a catcher actually from Reno, Steve LaRude. I went out there last fall to a baseball meetings out there, and I enjoyed it, but I agree. I'm not on my way back probably anytime soon.
1-2 is high, 2-2. I'm picturing a lot of brown mountains.
Yeah, a lot of that, a lot of mountains. Beautiful landscape. I mean, the landscape's beautiful.
And then there are the casinos.
Yep.
Can never forget about them. 2-2, and there goes Gillies from first, and a dropped ball as it was a knuckleball high, and no opportunity to throw down by the backstop. That's Rosario, and it'll be a stolen base for Tyson Gillies.
C. 6 steal for Gillies and 8 attempts with Lehigh Valley.
Gillies was ranked the 26th prospect and best defensive outfielder in the Phillies system by Baseball America. Right now, however, it's Cesar Hernandez with a 3-2 count against him. Here's the pitch, and it's fouled back in right in front of us behind home plate. We're creeping up on the 9 o'clock hour. We'll get you a station identification break in just a moment here on the Iron Pigs Radio Network. But right now it is 3-2 to the Iron Pigs second baseman, Cesar Hernandez. Hernandez retook the lead in triples with 8 yesterday in the International League. As here's the 3-2. Called strike 3. Oh. A knuckleball on the outside corner painted it, and there's one down with a man at second. That was about as well as you can place it right there.
No, I thought it was up and away.
It had to be, yeah. you think we allowed to say stuff like
yeah,
that?
You can say, you can say what you think it was. I mean, if it's out of the zone, it's out of the zone.
Cesar Hernandez certainly agreed with you two. Unfortunately for the Iron Pigs, the home plate umpire agreed with me. No count here to Freddie Galvis, who comes up with one down and a man at second, and the first pitch is taken high and away.
I always like to say that's why I'm not an umpire. Yeah.
Exactly. I wouldn't want to deal with 10,000 people critiquing me every night. Galvis is 0 for 2 with a walk. It was a 1-0, and he went fishing for that one way up high. But feel the breeze. It's 1-1. Just thinking about that national championship game this September, how amazing it would be if the Iron Pigs were in that game. The environment would be rocking to say the least as the 1-1 pitch is taken outside and knuckleball misses 2-1.
That's the way it was 2 years ago when they were in the playoffs. It was the noise level. They get a little noisy now, but the noise level during those playoff games here was incredible. And
there goes Gillies, but Galvis launches one deep to right field, and you can write it a postcard because she is long gone. Freddie Galvis, a two-run home run to right field, right into the Bud Light trough, and the Iron Pigs have extended their lead to 8-3 here in the bottom of the sixth inning. Freddie galvanizes the opposing pitcher, and the Iron Pigs have a 5-run lead. Well, it's been a while since we've seen this amount of power. The Iron Pigs at home haven't hit a lot of home runs, but we've seen Ashy go deep now, and here's Freddie Galvis.
So the noise level was, there weren't even sellouts to games.
There's a base hit to right field from Ashy. Cody is 4 for 4, Steve, and that's your favorite player right there delivering.
Yes, he is. I just had a t-shirt personalized last week to him. I should have worn it tonight, but.
Hey, you know what? Maybe you should never wear it again. You're lucky not wearing it.
There you go.
So the Iron Pigs have 2 runs in here with just 1 down, 12 hits on the evening after having 13, 13, and 11 the past 3 nights as the Pawtucket Red Sox have become the whooping boys of your Lehigh Valley Iron Pigs here in mid-July. That might do it, although it looks like it's just the pitching coach with his big jacket that John Schaefer does not like.
I've been talking a lot about it this week. He wears some heavy jackets for 85-degree nights. By the way, Phillies have gotten on the board. Darren Ruff is homered in Philadelphia tonight. A solo shot in the seventh. Phillies are trailing 4-1. Good to see, though, Ruff contributing. Ryan Howard had successful surgery today. Is expected to miss 6 weeks or so.
Maybe another rehab here like last year.
Very possible. Absolutely.
Of course, since Howard has gone down and they are showing the Darren Ruff home run on the Jumbotron here at Coca-Cola Park. Since Howard's gone down, Darren Ruff has gone up, and he has been stellar. The Phillies, beg your pardon, have certainly been following. Right now, however, they trail. We'll give you a legal ID in just a moment. Cody Overbeck will step in, and for Cody, an opportunity here to pinch hit for Josh Fields. Fieldsy went down 0 for 3 with 2 strikeouts. Certainly, maybe just doesn't like the knuckleballer as Overbeck takes a ball low, 1-0. For Galvis, it was home run number 2. second career in the IL, not including his postseason home run back in 2011. There goes Ashy, and Overbeck way out in front of the 72-mile-per-hour off-speed pitch. Ashy does not garner a throw, and just like that, the Iron Pigs have another runner in scoring position. What a day for Cody Ashy, gentlemen.
It is unbelievable. The stolen base, the home run, the four hits, the, what is it, five RBIs?
Correct.
Would that be considered uncontested, or does he get credit for stolen
base? He gets credit.
As the 1-1 pitch is another knuckleball swung on and missed. Overbeck pulls off on it, and it's going to be 1-2. Bottom of the sixth inning here from Coca-Cola Park, 8-3 Iron Pigs. It's 1-2 to Cody Overbeck, pinch hitting for Josh Fields. Here's the pitch, and it's grounded. Cue shot, tough play, and it's through for a base hit on the right side. A seeing eye single. Ashy read it beautifully. He'll be coming home, and the Iron Pigs take a 6-run lead. 9-3 as Cody Overbeck gives the Iron Pigs another run here in the sixth inning. And with that, let's pause 10 seconds for station identification here on the Iron Pigs Radio Network. So the stolen base by Ashy after his fourth hit of the game, and we're just in the sixth inning, folks. Brings in a run after Overbeck's seeing eye single, and Dave Brundage can do no wrong right now. He calls on Cody Overbeck, and he delivers. It'll be Eric Kratz here in the bottom of the sixth inning. One down, man on first. Three runs already in. And after the meeting of the apostles on the mound, Hager will remain in this ballgame. And we'll try to pick off Overbeck at first. I wouldn't expect Cody to steal, not exactly a base stealer.
In a situation like this where the pitcher's really getting beaten up, sometimes it's hard to figure why he's still in the game, except for the fact that their bullpen has been spent pretty well.
Absolutely. They need to find the innings. They've had a lot of bullpen innings the last two nights, playing three games. They trailed this by six, so now they're just trying to get outs.
Iron Pigs and Paul Sox here from Coca-Cola Park, bottom of the sixth inning, and Charlie Hager set with the first pitch to Eric Kratz. This one's lined to second. It's going to be one, might be two. Back at time at first, just barely. Overbeck decided not to slide on the play made by Henry. Gunned it over to first, but Overbeck got back.
Well, he cost himself a double play by catching the ball. If he lets it bounce, it's an easy double play with the catcher running, but instead a line out for out number two.
So two down here in the bottom of the sixth inning. Pigs scoring three runs in the third, three in the fourth, and three in the sixth. And just like that, they've tripled up the Pawtucket Red Sox 9-3. Looking to complete the sweep of their division rivals and move to within three games of first place in the IL North.
How about that particular stat?
Steve Stustors takes a knuckleball in the outside corner, strike one. You're absolutely correct. Coming into this series, there was an opportunity for an eight-game swing, and if this score holds up through the last four innings, the Iron Pigs will have made good on their opportunity. A pickoff move to first. Overbeck moseys back in time. 0-1. Of course, the Iron Pigs will get set to continue their opportunities against division rivals. More on that after this pitch. The 0-1 from Hager, and Sustorf will swing. Cue shot, that's going to drop over the third baseman's head for a base hit. Overbeck will hold up at second base, and another dink and dunk base hit. A tweener and a duck, and the Iron Pigs have two men on base with two down here in the bottom of the sixth inning.
How about 14 hits off a starting pitcher tonight, John? I mean, that's truly a remarkable number. We're only in the sixth inning. Iron Pigs offensively have been on a tear in this series. They entered at 307 against Pawtucket this year. That's in nine games. They've had 14 hits tonight.
Well, Charlie Hager's walks and hits per innings pitch is going to take a bit of a hit here. 14 hits allowed by the right-hander. It's going to be Minimark stepping into the dish. Michael Martinez looking for an opportunity with two down.
The hitting binge actually began on the road trip. Got a lot of hits over the weekend in Scranton, just not timely at that point.
Certainly, and the Iron Pigs have made them timely, even if they weren't hard hit in this game.
Incredible, right?
First pitch is a knuckleball for a strike to Minimark, nothing in one. It's the Iron Pigs' seven-hole hitter. He's 0 for 3, as he fouls one off his foot. Nothing in two to Michael Martinez. Pigs have put three across. They've got two fish on the pond here. Overbeck at second, along with Steve Sussdorf at first. Sussdorf, 2 for 2 with two walks. He and Cody Ashy have been on a combined eight times. So Mini Mart will be in the hole 0-2. Hager's pitch is outside with a knuckler, 1-2. Keep watching these knuckleballs, and my play-by-play is going to be off for tomorrow night's game. I'm going to be behind everything. Hopefully the Iron Pigs don't suffer the same fate, because tomorrow they get a very good pitcher, Thad Weber, and the Buffalo Bisons. Here's the 1-2, and another knuckleball's inside. It gets away from the backstop, and the runners will advance. So now Mini Mart, with two down in a 2-2 pitch, will have a chance to bring in two more with a base hit. That's the first time that we've seen a ball get past Rosario. It's always difficult catching knuckleballers, as Eric Kratz mentioned today on the AT&T pregame show, a great interview he had with Kenny Ayers. The Jet is in the studio right now. Appreciate the work he's doing, filling in for yours truly. Opportunity to feel some fresh air. Here's the 2-2 just off the outside corner with another knuckleball. Great eye for Mini Mart. The count will be full. 2 men in scoring position. That's Overbeck at third, Sussdorf at second. 2 down, 3-2. Hager delivers, high ball 4. A missed up with a knuckleball, and the bases will be juiced for Pete Orr. Pigs have batted around here in the sixth inning. You're listening to the Iron Pigs lead the Pawtucket Red Sox 9-3, as it looks like we are going to have a pitching change. DeSarcina takes to the mound, and the Iron Pigs will see a new pitcher. This call to the bullpen is brought to you by AT&T, the preferred wireless provider of the Lehigh Valley Iron Pigs. Switch to the nation's fastest broadband network, AT&T. Rethink possible. We'll take a 90-second break here on the Iron Pigs Radio Network. When we'll come back, we'll tell you who the new pitcher is for Gary DeSarcina's Pawtucket Red Sox. It's 9-3 Iron Pigs, bottom of the sixth, on the Iron Pigs Radio Network. Well, we appreciate it, Kenny Ayers, all the work you're doing in there and all the work you do out here at Coca-Cola Park on a regular basis. The new pitcher for the Pawtucket Red Sox with two down here in the sixth inning is going to be a right-hander by the name of Clayton Mortensen, 28 years old, in his seventh professional season, second with the Red Sox organization. He was acquired from the Colorado Rockies in exchange for Marco Scudero back in January of 2012. On the season, no record, no saves, and an ERA of 6.00. Last year, he made 26 appearances over six stints with the Red Sox in the major leagues, so he's got some experience. And he'll have quite a bit of work up ahead of him as the bases are juiced. The Iron Pigs will send Pete Orr to the plate with an opportunity to blow this thing wide open. Orr will step in against Mortensen. It's 9-3 Iron Pigs. Two down, bases juice. Overbeck at third, Sussdorf at second, Mini Mart at first, and an opportunity for Orr. Pete on the night, 0-3, two flyouts and a ground out to second. Orr steps in, and Clayton Mortensen will certainly be a rude awakening after the 70-mile-per-hour knuckleballs they've been seeing. Here's the first pitch from the right-hander, and it's a fastball, 84. That was taken high for ball one, 1-0. Pete on the year hitting .229 with 3 home runs and 19 RBIs. 0-3 on the day. Here's the set and the 1-0 pitch, and it's lifted right up a mile-high pop-up in front of the Paw Sox dugout, and the play is made by Alberto Rosario. So the Iron Pigs threaten with the bases juice, but they'll have to settle for the 3 runs that they did score. Pigs put 3 across the board, and they have taken a 6-run lead. We head to a break and to the 7th. Pigs lead the Paw Sox 9-3 here on the Iron Pigs Radio Network.
Thank you.